and say, since I lay, now why you go and do that? Glory, glory, hallelujah, since I lay.
Day, and then everyone returned to spend the night in the camp.
Joshua went out over early the next morning, and the priests again carried the ark of the Lord. The seven priests with the ram's horn marched in front of the ark of the Lord, blowing their horns. Again, the armed men marched both in front of the priests with the horns and behind the ark of the Lord. At this time, the priests were blowing their horns. On the second day, they again marched around the town once and returned to camp. They followed this pattern for 6 days. On the seventh day, the Israelites got up at dawn, marched around the town as they had done before. But this time, they went around the town 7 times. The seventh time around, as the prophet sounded the long blast on the horn, Joshua commanded the people, "Shout! For the Lord has given you the town." Let us focus on that underscore pinpoint with laser precision, the B clause of verse number 5. Then the walls of the town will collapse, and the people can charge straight into the town. Repeat these words after me. Then the walls of the town will collapse. I want you to look at your neighbor, and I want you to put a smile on your face and look at your neighbor and say, "Neighbor or neighbor, bringing down the walls." Look across the room and smile at somebody. Say, "Neighbor or neighbor, I didn't come to bother you. I didn't come to stir your Kool-Aid. But it's time to bring down the walls." Wonderful God, in Jesus' name, as we prepare our hearts now for the teaching and preaching of your word. God, we pray that your spirit will guide us as your word goes forth in power and authority to accomplish that for which it was sent. Wonderful God, I want to thank you right now for the greater one who lives within us. In your name, God, I pray that the Holy Ghost, who is the convictor, convincer, and persuader of truth, will reveal the truth about the power and integrity of your word to every listener. And God, we pray right now that your word will be health to our bodies, strength to our hearts, renewal to our minds. We give you thanks, we give you honor, we give you praise. In Jesus' name, and all of God's people said, amen. God bless you, ushers. You may be seated. If you are honest with yourself today, there are walls in your life that are keeping you from your destiny. Yes, there are walls that are boundaries that have been enclosed you in a tight, secure area that is keeping you away from your deliverance. I believe it in my spirit today that if you are honest with yourself, that you perhaps build walls surrounding you that have hindered you from obtaining the promises that God has given in your life. Perhaps someone listening to me today is trapped behind the wall of sickness. Every time you turn around, there is something going wrong in your body. Do I have a witness in here? All you have to take a pill to get up in the morning, a pill to stimulate your appetite, a pill to move around, a pill to keep you mellow, a pill to keep you up, a pill to put you asleep, and even a pill to make sure that you stay asleep all night. Perhaps I'm speaking to someone right now who is trapped behind the wall of sickness. You just can't seem to get your sugar right. Just can't seem to get your blood pressure stabilized. If your head isn't hurting, your arms are. If your arms are not hurting, your back is. If your back is not hurting, your knees are aching. Perhaps you're tired of going to the doctor's office 4 or 5 times a week, paying copay after copay, and nothing ever changing. Perhaps someone is worn out for being trapped behind the wall of sickness, and they need the walls to come down. Perhaps someone listening to me today is trapped behind the wall of estrangement. Strange is defined to turn from an affectionate attitude to an indifferent or unfriendly one. Perhaps someone is stuck behind the wall of hostility. You are always upset with everybody, including yourself. Nobody wants to be bothered with you. People see you coming and they start walking the other way. You don't ever have anything good to say. All you seem to do is fuss. If the sun is shining, you are fussing because it's hot. If the sun is not shining, you're fussing because it's cold. If you find yourself, mad because it rained, mad because it didn't rain, mad because you had to get up in the morning. Your children don't come to visit. Cousins don't come by. Sister and brother see your name on their call ID. They refuse to click over or answer the phone. You can't seem to have a healthy relationship with anybody because you know everything there is to know about everything. Perhaps someone is listening to me. You're trained of being alone. You're trained because you don't have any friends. You're trained because you don't have anybody to call your own. You're trained because you don't have anybody to love. Perhaps you desire for the walls to come down. Look at your neighbor right now. Say, neighbor, I want the walls to come down. There are walls. There are walls in this place that need to come down today. There are walls of confusion, walls of torment, walls of financial disaster, walls of pain, walls of disgust. Beloved, I drove into work to tell you, to decree and declare into your life that these walls shall come down. Our unit, our selected portion of the sacred text for examination, is housed in the book of Joshua. The book of Joshua gives us a story of conquest, genocide, a testimony of two faith, a statistical record, and geography. The book of Joshua narrates how, under Joshua's leadership, the protection of Yahweh, Israel entered Canaan and there imprinted a place for herself. Ah, Brother Amy, the text indicates that the gates of Jericho were securely shut. Jericho sat at the intersection of an important trade route, Dr. Jackie, in the Jordan Valley. Thus, Jericho had become the commercial center for that era. The text indicates that no one was allowed in and no one was allowed out. Ah, the text indicates that God advised Joshua that he had given Israel Jericho, its king, and everything that goes along with it. Brother Augustus, the text indicates that God directed Joshua to have the people to march around the city once a day for 6 days. Susan, the text indicates that God directed Joshua to have 7 ministers to walk ahead of the ark, and that each minister should be carrying a ram's horn. Yes, Sister Gladys, the text advises that Joshua was to direct the people that on the 7th day to march around the city 7 times, and on the 7th trip around, wait for the signal, and then shout with all your might. Coach Floyd, the text indicates that Joshua called a board meeting with the people. The text indicates that Joshua gave the people their instructions. Solomon, the text indicates that Joshua advised the people not to make a single sound, not Ms. Gale, to make a peep, not to say a word until the signal was given to shout. The text indicates that Joshua armed guards to walk in front of the ministers and some behind the ministers who were carrying the ark. I believe, St. Paul, as we engage in this hermeneutical exercise, that there are profound prophetic truths in the text that, when properly applied to our lives, will tremendously facilitate, Brother Lamar, us in destroying our walls. Are y'all ready to get on the train? Are y'all ready to bring down the walls in your life? Well, here we go. First of all, if you're going to bring down the walls in your life, you need to worship. Look at your neighbor. Say, neighbor. Oh, neighbor, it's time to worship. Look at it, Aunt Joanne. Look at it. It's in the text. Israel marched for 6 days, but the power was in place on the 7th day. Beloved, please catch this piece this morning. Catch it. Worship allows us to call on the presence of God, to be filled with the presence of God, and to usher in the presence of God. Did you hear what I said? Worship allows us to call on the presence of God, to be filled filled with the presence of God and to be ushered into the presence of God. Worship allows us to call on the presence of God, to be filled with the presence of God, and to be ushered into the presence of God. Beloved, I've discovered that worship is only powerful when there is preparation. Look at your neighbor right now. Say, neighbor, oh neighbor, worship is only powerful when there is preparation. Oh, beloved, I can't wait until Sunday to begin my worship. I get excited. Oh, but nurse, I need to have preparation on Monday to prepare for my worship. Do you hear what I'm saying? You see, the reason why some of us leave the same way that we came in, it's all because there has not been preparation for your worship. Do you hear what I'm saying today? You will never be able to bring the walls down, Mother Horton, in your life until you learn how to worship. Look at your neighbor. Say, neighbor, oh neighbor, I want to learn how to worship. Baby, I can't cuss folk out all week and expect power to come from my worship. Did you hear what I said? I can't talk about everybody and every rumor I heard on Tuesday and think that my worship will be powerful on Sunday. I can't be layered in my Jesus juice all week long and expect power to be revealed in my worship on Sunday. There must be preparation. It is only through devout prayer and preparation that we will be able to open the windows of heaven, that we'll be able to transcend the powers of evil, that we'll be able to witness the overthrow of defeat, that we'll be able to claim the promises of God, that we'll be able to experience the joys of heaven, that we'll be able to disclose the foretaste of glory, and that we'll be able to uncover the secrets of eternity. Therefore, right now, in Jesus' name, I declare and decree that where you are is holy ground. Look at your neighbor right now. Say, neighbor, or neighbor, I declare and decree that where I sit is holy ground. Now, if you believe that, Susan, you ought to lift up your hands and say, Lord, I give myself away. Do I have any worshipers in here that you're ready to give yourself away? That you're ready to ask God to fill you with God present? You're ready to be ushered into the presence of God. Lift your hands and say, Lord, here I am. I'm thine, O Lord. I heard thy voice. Lord, I give myself to you. I give you my mind. I give you my heart. I give you my body. I give you my praise. I give you my service. Lord, I come to worship you. You are a holy God. You are a mighty God. You are a powerful God. All the ground I stand on is holy ground. You gotta worship. Not only do you have to worship, McCarthy, but you need to keep God in the middle. Look at your neighbor. Say, neighbor, or neighbor, whatever you do, make sure you keep God in the middle. Look at the text. Look at the text, Sandra. God directed them to carry the Ark of the Covenant while they were marching. If you are ever going to destroy the walls that are hindering you, then you're going to have to keep God in the middle. Beloved, God had already given them the city. I want you to catch that piece. God had already, Dr. Amica, put your ordination in place. God had already, Mother Wilford, put your healing in place. However, God directed them to carry the ark so that they would be reminded that God was with them. Look at your neighbor. Say, neighbor, or neighbor, God wants to remind us that God is with us. Beloved, symbols, symbols direct our heart and remind us of God's wonder-working power. And I'm reminded state of California. Morris Brown wanted that money, and I sure enough didn't have it. But what I did have, Brother Heckles, was a hymnal that my mother had put in my suitcase. So you know what I did? I turned to hymn number 437 because I had heard him sing it all every Wednesday night. And there in Wilkes Hall, on the corner of Sunset and MLK, on the third floor, Chapter Jackie, I opened my mouth and I said, "Be not dismayed, whatever be tied, God will take care of you. Beneath his wings of love abide. God will take care of you. God will take care of you through every day or all the way. God will take care of you." Look at your neighbor right now and say, "Neighbor, I'm a witness. God will take care of you." And do I have any witnesses out here who've had some bad days? You had some weary days, Brother Gladys and the Gladys. You had some sleepless nights. Do I have anybody that has had some upset moments in their life? And you all messed up. You caught up in your feelings and you don't know what to do. But you saw grandmother's Bible sitting on the bookshelf and you pulled it out and you decided to open it up. You had never opened it up before, but you pulled it off the shelf and you opened it up, and somehow, some way, Mother Trent, it opened up to the page that read, "The Lord is my light and my salvation." Do I have a witness out there? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom I shall be afraid. Do I have a witness out there? And that is why I've learned, church folk, I've learned to keep God in the middle of it all. No matter what I'm going through, I've learned to keep God in the middle of it all, Sister Gwen. When God is in the middle, God will remind the believer that everything will be all right. Now, if you sure enough believe that, why don't you look at your neighbor right now and tell your neighbor everything will be all right. Do I have a witness out here? Oh, everything will be all right, because every now and then when I'm harassed by life, God reminds me that God will bring me out of darkness into light, out of despair into delight, out of turmoil into peace, out of anxiety into assurance, out of sorrow into joy, out of emptiness into fullness, out of misery into glory, and out of nothing into something. Do I have any believers in here who are listening to me that you're going through what you're going through, and you need to be reminded that God will take care of you? So why don't you look at your neighbor right now and encourage your neighbor and tell your neighbor, God is able. Oh, now come on, and if you believe that God is able, I need you to look like you know that God is able. Because I imagine, Brother Roosevelt, you've been through some stuff in your life, and it was nobody but the Lord. I imagine, Susan, you've been through something in your life, and it was nobody but the Lord. Gail, you've been through some stuff in your life, and it was nobody but the Lord. Yeah, Miss Jenny, you've been through something in your life, and it was nobody but the Lord. Letta, you've been through something in your life, but it was nobody but the Lord. Anchor, you've been through something in your life, but it was nobody but the Lord. Well, if you know it was nobody, then you might as well say, God is able. God is able to pick me up. God is able to turn things around. God is able to heal my body. God is able to break down a door. God is able to open up a door. God is able to give me a job. God is able to pay my bill. God is able to heal my body. God is able. Wish I had a witness in here. Not only is God able, but you gotta exercise. You gotta exercise. You gotta exercise. If you gonna bring these walls down, Coach Floyd, you better exercise the fine art of closing your mouth. Look at your neighbor. Say, neighbor or neighbor, learn to be quiet. Look at the text. Look at the text. Look at the text. Learn how to keep your mouth closed. Zephaniah chapter 2 verse 13, it reads, "Be silent before the Lord, all humanity, For God is springing into action from God's holy dwelling. Some of us need to learn how to close our mouths and allow God an opportunity to spring into action. Look at the text in verse 10. Joshua directed the people to close their mouths. Don't utter a word, Sister Lamar, until the signal is given. Beloved, you need to understand that when you are silent, the enemy does not know what you're thinking and does not know what you are saying. James Hedia, somebody listening to me, you need to learn how to shut up and let God speak. Stop doing all the talking. Let God speak. Romans chapter 8 and verse 26 teaches us, and if the Holy Spirit helps us in our weakness, for example, Caleb, we do not know what God wants us to pray for, but the Holy Spirit prays for us with groaning that cannot be expressed with words. That's what the Bible says. Some of us are defeated, Caleb, before the day begins, just because we opened up our mouths and we spoke defeat before our feet hit the floor. Baby, you better learn to close your mouth. And you better close your mouth. You don't have to have the last word. You better allow God to speak. Allow God to speak over your life. Allow God to have the last words concerning your future. Close your mouth and allow God to speak order into your situation. Close your mouth and allow God to speak favor in your life. Close your mouth. Baby, you need to be quiet in order to hear. Dr. Houston, I know I got some school teachers up in here, and you've taught them for a number of years that I can't talk when you're talking in the classroom. If you're going to listen to me, you better close your mouth. God is saying the same thing. Close your mouth. Listen to what the Lord is saying. Can you hear God speaking? Listen, God is telling you right now, you're the head and not the tail. Can you hear God talking? Close your mouth. Listen, God is telling you that there's nothing too hard for God. Can you hear God? Listen, God is telling you that no weapon formed against you will prosper. Listen, God is telling you that God has good plans for your life. God is telling you right now that you need to plant the seeds and wait for the harvest. Look at your neighbor and tell your neighbor, God is trying to tell you something. Do I have a believer in here that you're going to listen to God? You're going to wait to hear what God is saying. Obey that wait on the strength and soul. The text teaches us to worship. The text teaches us with a horn to keep God in the middle. The text teaches us, family, that we need, yes, to close our mouths and listen to the voice of God. But Susan, I need to clock out now. And the text teaches us that you need to shout. Oh Lord, if you are going to bring the walls down in your life, you are going to have to get your shout ready. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, oh neighbor, get your shout ready. Now, Sister Allen, I know you think it's an oxymoron for me to tell you to close your mouth and then to tell you to open your mouth. But what the text tells us, that shout your praise to God. Yes, beloved, God is about to spring into action. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, oh, neighbor, Stand up if you know the church.